morning. Welcome to Hardin County Commissioners Court. Today is Tuesday, March 21st, 2023, and it is 10 a.m. We're here today for a special meeting, a workshop to discuss a few items. If everyone will please rise for the invocation, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. Dear Lord, thank you for the many men and women that work hard every day to make Hardin County a great place to live and a better place for the future. Thank you also for all of the hundreds of thousands of men and women who protect our country and our state and our county every day. We appreciate each and every one of them and ask you to protect them each day and night. Amen.
Amen.
And the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We're here today for a workshop. The first item that we will discuss is an update from the committee on proposed changes to the subdivision regulations. And the chairperson of that committee is Commissioner Young. And I guess before we begin with that, is there any commissioner that wants to go out of order for any reason, or are we good with the order that's on the agenda?
Good with the order.
All right. Commissioner Young, please proceed.
Okay. We have taken Chambers County subdivision regulations and kind of just revamped them for Hardin County purposes. And some of the major changes that we've made, the regulations are about 81 pages, so we've been working on it for a while. The first thing that we have changed is, in addition to and included in the subdivision regulations, there will also be a Hardin County Drainage Criteria Manual and Hardin County Infrastructure Manual. The drainage criteria manual that they have is about another 81 pages. It's very descriptive of what we would expect from the developers, engineers, and exactly how we want it to be set up and all of their reports to be submitted. The infrastructure manual will be a little bit shorter than theirs. Theirs is about 51 pages, but it includes a lot of public works, a lot of water and sewer that we don't do, so we'll be taking that out, and it'll include things like, one of the major changes that we've looked at so far is on our outfall ditches in the subdivisions. Right now we have a lot of erosion because the hydro seed just doesn't work on some of the soil that we have, so we're putting in there that they have to be concreted or have riprap to stop some of the erosion before we even take it in. We are also going to establish a development review committee, and a mandatory development review committee needs to be scheduled at the initial phases of development and design and before preliminary plat will be accepted by the county. This meeting will help developers learn how the process will function moving forward. Engineering for developer and the county, emergency services district, the 911 network, municipal utilities district, and floodplain / subdivision designee will be present to help answer any questions during this meeting. Plans shall be submitted online to the county subdivision designee for all departments to review before the tract is subdivided, establishing more than one lot, any street, alley, easement, or public right-of-way, or before any building, street, drainage, or utility construction has begun. This will give us a chance to take a look at their plans, make sure that they know all of our regulations, and including the ESDs. We have more ESDs in the county that have adopted codes, the fire protection code. So this will give them a chance also for to talk to them about fire hydrants and placement of fire lanes and all that. The construction plans shall show locations of all utilities, illuminations, transformers, signs, fences, sidewalks, and landscaping. We've run across issues where these items have been placed on top of utilities, making it difficult to access them for maintenance or repairs. We have Lumbers and Mud on the committee, and that was one of the things that they're having a lot of problems with in Lumberton. They're building the big brick fences around the subdivision for noise control, but they're putting on top of the water lines and stuff, they've had a lot of breakages, and it's just difficult for them to access to even do any maintenance on them. So we'll have that on the plat where it shows everything that's going in, all of the streets lights, anything. Notes to be included on the final plat. Drainage and other improvements outside of county road right-of-way will be maintained by the subdivision developer, the municipal utility district, neighborhood association, homeowners association, or other legal entity assuming this responsibility for such maintenance and liability. This is something that we just had a form for before. Once the county takes in the subdivision, we don't maintain the drainage, the detention ponds and that kind of stuff. So we had a form saying who would be taking care of those. Now it'll be required to be on the final plat, so it'll be a lot easier to find and to look up.
I really appreciate that.
Yeah.
That's very good.
Thank you. Owner shall dedicate to the county a strip of land 20 foot wide on each side of any and all gullies, ravines, draws, sloughs, rivers, or other natural drainage conveyances located in or adjacent to said subdivision as easements for drainage purposes, giving the county the right to enter upon said easement at any and all times for purpose of maintaining or improving drainage. So we all know how difficult sometimes it is to get a landowner to allow you access to maintain any of these, so we're going to require that they give us an easement if and when we need to use it. No driveway constructed on any lot within any subdivision shall be permitted access onto a public roadway unless a permit for culvert installation is issued. The County Road and Bridge Department has approved the culvert size and grade. Hardin County reserves the right to install all driveway culverts in the subdivision before it is accepted into the maintenance system. And the driveway satisfies the minimum spacing requirements in these subdivision regulations or the county's then current spacing requirements for such driveways. In the past, we've had issues with different contractors installing culverts in the subdivision before we take it in, and they're all on different grades and all that. So it'll be up to each commissioner if they want to take on that. I think we will be doing that. It's just a lot easier to go ahead and install them all than have to fix them later when they have concrete on them.
Yep. Thank you.
At least two means of ingress and egress from subdivisions to existing arterial and or collector roads are required in subdivisions consisting of 300 or more lots. Where two ingress and egress points are required, each shall be remotely connected to an arterial and or collector road, a distance apart equal to not less than half of the length of the diagonal distance of the overall area to be served, measured in a straight line between them. If an energy or utility easement or right-of-way bisects a subdivision in a manner that may prevent residents from crossing said easement or right-of-way in the event of the failure, leakage, or collapse thereof, at least one means of ingress and egress to an arterial or collector road shall be provided on each side of the easement. This is for subdivisions that have pipelines going through them, gas lines, and all that. If there's, we have a lot of subdivisions that have one way in and one way out. And so this will require for any of the large subdivisions, 300 or more, to have more than one way in and one way out. And if there is a pipeline or something that could fail and trap the residents, that they have to have an additional way out. Cul-de-sac termination of residential streets are required on all dead-end streets. Turnaround shall be a minimum of 96 feet of paved diameter unless an exception is made by the ESD. This is a requirement in the National Fire Protection Association codes and standards. Our previous requirement was 60 foot in diameter, which we thought was adequate and sufficient, but the larger the fire trucks, the harder it is to get in and turn around. If you have people parked on the cul-de-sac, they can't get in and turn around. They have to back up all the way down the road. So this is a standard that has been adopted by a couple of the ESDs as part of the National Fire Protection Association codes. The building setback line on all TxDOT highways and major county roads shall be 50 feet from the edge of the right-of-way. The building setback line on all public roads other than major highways and roads shall be 25 feet from the edge of the right-of-way. Before, we had 10 feet. And we had a lot of instances where fences were built in our right-of-way. So this should keep them a good distance out of our way. So.
Do we have that ability with the legislature?
I had heard once we didn't have the ability to establish setback lines on the county, so that's.
We always have had setback lines.
Okay.
I
knew the right of way from the center of the road.
Mm-hmm.
And outside of that, I didn't know we had any.
We do, in our current subdivision regulations, it's 10 feet on each side and in the front and back. So I'll look into that, but I've never heard of that, so.
I think it's a great idea.
Rural mailboxes shall be set 3 feet from the edge of the pavement or behind curbs when used. All mailboxes within county arterial right-of-way shall meet the current textile standards. Any mailbox that does not meet this requirement may be removed by Hardin County. I don't know if y'all have this in your area, but some of our newer subdivisions are putting them right on the side of the road. And it's difficult for two vehicles to pass without getting really close to some burnt mailbox. Minor plats. The county engineer will recommend that the county approve a small subdivision if the property owner and or developer does not lay out streets, alleys, squares, parks, or other parts of the tract intended to be dedicated to public use or for the use of purchasers or owners of lots fronting on or adjacent to streets, alleys, squares, parks, or other parts. No more than 4 parts result from the subdivision of a tract of land, and each part is at least 1 net acre in area. Easements do not count as part of the tract. Subdivision of a tract of land resulting in each parcel being 10 acres or more is exempt from the minor plat requirements if developer does not lay out streets, alleys, squares, parks, or other parts of the tract intended to be dedicated to the public. The original parcel to be divided cannot be the result of a division using the small subdivision process within 5 years from the date of application. So we have some instances where people have access, all of the frontage is on a county road or state highway, so that has been exempt from any platting requirements. Well, as long as they don't put in any more streets or drainage or easements or anything like that, we're not requiring them to do a plat, but we are requiring them to do a survey and to have the survey filed with each lot. So it wouldn't be a plat with drainage criteria and all that unless it's required. But if it's just a regular minor plat, then that's something that we can just approve. And the 10 acres or more has always been exempt if they don't put in roads or drainage. We did add the 5 years. That way, if somebody has several acres and they only want to split up a couple of them right now, well, they're going to have to wait 5 years before they can do it again unless they submit like a master plan showing how everything is going to be split up. Each part has adequate, separate, not shared, access to a publicly maintained road with at least 60 foot of frontage along such road. This has changed from the 30 foot frontage requirement that we had. And that was also due to utilities. We're having some issues with them being able to get utilities in such a tight area. The proposed division is not expected to have adverse impact on drainage as confirmed in writing by the subdivision designee or by the County Road and Bridge Department in which it is located. Each part is suitable size and condition to allow the provision of adequate water systems and sewer service facilities as confirmed in writing by the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality or the respective utility district in which the property is located. Property owner and or developer shall provide necessary right-of-way dedications and setbacks. Under procedure, the property owner and or developer shall meet with the county subdivision designee. Property owner and or developer shall provide the county subdivision designee a sketch that of what is proposed and a copy of the deed of the tract being divided. So we just want to make sure that they own the land. Also, we would require that a tax statement showing that all the taxes are current before we would accept their survey.
Shirley smiled about that.
Thank you.
Threw that in for you.
Thank you.
If the proposed division meets the county's requirements, the property owner and or developer will then be responsible for getting a letter from the county subdivision designee, a tax certificate showing that all taxes are paid on the tract. The property owner and or developer will also be responsible for obtaining a plat of survey from a land surveyor containing a legal description of all tracts created. Upon approval, the county subdivision designee will supply the property owner and or developer with a letter granting approval, which shall be filed along with a plat of survey signed and sealed by the land surveyor.
Commissioner, on number three, where it says upon approval, who is that? Commissioner's Court approval?
Yes. We would still bring it to Commissioner's Court just to, it's not something we would have to sign a plat or anything like that, but we would still want to bring it to Commissioner's Court, let everybody know what's going on. We'd have a survey of the lots. And then once we approve that they have provided everything that we require, then they can file it. So it's not going to be an extenuous review process for the engineers and stuff if it's just a small minor plat. No lots or conveyances of any property within the area of an unrecorded plat may be made until the improvements necessary to ensure access, utilities, and drainage have been completed to a point that the land or lots to be conveyed have full public services available directly to such property. So we've had some instances in the past where they filed a final plat, they were able to go ahead and start selling the lots, and they didn't have the water and sewer and utilities available. So we just have this in there to make sure that if somebody buys a lot, they can immediately build on it. If the Commissioner's Court approves the final plat, the owner or developer may begin construction of the development. However, the county engineer will withhold the two signed copies of the final plat for recording until all improvements are completed in accordance with the improvement plans. If within 3 years no improvements have been made and no request for an extension has been made by the property owner and or developer and approved by the county engineer may request the court to abandon the plat and cancel the subdivision pursuant to Texas Local Government Code 232.008. We have lots of subdivisions that were platted in my area was the early 1900s. I have plats from 1903 that were built out in 2020. And we didn't have the same requirements, the same the easements that we require in our current regulations were not platted. They weren't accepted back then. So it caused a big problem. And so we just put in there that if within the 3 years they have not started any development, we can cancel it and they can start over. If an owner or developer desires to file a final plat prior to roads and drainage improvements being completed, then the owner or developer shall provide a bond of 150% of cost of all remaining roads, drainage elements, and other improvements to be constructed as identified by the developer's engineers. This is a lot bigger bond than what we required before.
Amanda, on 13,
mm-hmm.
Will that be an automatic, or will that be like, will when they enter into the agreement, will it automatically default to cancel, or will we have to bring it back to Commissioner's Court?
We would have to do it in court.
Okay. And would that be recommendation of our engineers, or would it be upon the commissioner?
We could do it as recommendation from the engineer. It does say that the county engineer may request the court to abandon it.
Okay.
So they would have to bring it to court to us.
But the commissioner could do that as well, right? You wouldn't
right.
have to rely on the engineer. You could do it yourself if you wanted to, right?
Yeah, we could. We could go through the process. There is an abandonment process that we'd have to go through. But we can do it ourselves. After the 2 years or more by extension, 50% or more build out and completion of homes or buildings and a request to accept the subdivision roads and drainage dedicated to the public into the county maintenance system, the county engineer or his or her designated employees or agents will inspect the subdivision improvements and provide a written punch list to the owner or developer for repair, construction, or implementation. Supplemental new punch lists will be required if punch list items are not completed within 3 months. Once all items are inspected, completed, and approved as compliant, then the county engineer shall make a recommendation to the commissioner's court to accept the roads and road drainage into the county maintenance system. So before we would go out and do the final walkthrough, the engineer would have a punch list provided to the developer, but we didn't have a time limit on it. I have one right now that we gave him a punch list a year and a half ago. So we added the 3 months, and if they have not completed the punch list within the 3 months, then the engineer will go back out there and see if they need to add anything to the punch list, basically. Boundary closure calculation, computer printout or calculation sheet, 100-year and 500-year floodplain map showing proposed plat boundaries, topographic map showing proposed plat boundary. This was not required before, and we just started working on this part. We only required the 100-year floodplain be on the plat. Now we're requiring that the 500-year also be on the plat. And that's what we have so far. Right now we're in the appendices working through those to make sure that they correlate with the changes that we've made. This will be additional documents that will have to be filed or completed by the developer. So we're working on that, and then we'll jump into the drainage criteria manual. It is 81 pages of engineer language. So we have a couple of engineers that are on the committee that have said that they will kind of take charge of that and make sure that they're changing everything that needs to be changed, and then we'll review it as a committee. So do y'all have any questions?
I have one quick question. It might already be in the current subdivisions regulations, and I'm not aware, but is there any provision when a developer obtains approval for phase one and they get ready to start phase two, do they have to be substantially complete with phase one, or can they just go ahead and obtain approval for phase two before they've actually even started phase one or gotten very far into phase one?
I don't remember if that's in our current regulations or not, but it's something that we have talked about and we are going to add to these.
Okay.
I just forgot to include that. But
okay.
We do have that in our notes to add that. I know we have
and then,
some large developments.
Do you when do you anticipate that y'all have everything ready to come to court to approve the new regulations? Or is it going to be done in phases, or is everything going to be brought at one time?
We'll bring it all at once. And I suspect this was the hardest to go through. We had to read word for word, page by page, to make sure what we wanted to change. I feel like the other two documents are going to go a lot faster. Like I said, the infrastructure manual, we're going to take a lot of that out because it's public works, water and sewer. And the drainage manual, most of that is just an explanation and description of what we're requiring and how we want it presented. So I don't expect it to take too long. Hopefully we'll be done within the next 3 or 4 months. We're meeting once after commissioner's court.
Yeah, you've had lots of meetings. Spent a lot of time on this.
Mm-hmm.
Thank y'all. And I think y'all are also engaging some of the developers as well as y'all go through this.
We are. We have a couple of developers that have gone above and beyond for Hardin County, and they've completed their developments. And we have a couple of them. We have the cities, we have Lumberton Mud, we have been in talks with the ESD. We're going to have some of them come and talk to us about their requirements. We want to make sure we're all uniform and on the same page. I've talked to Entergy. They are going to come and talk to us about their right-of-way requirements because they just went up to 15 to 20 foot requirement, and we were only requiring 10 feet. So we still have some people that are going to come in and talk with us and give us some guidance on some things. Also wanted to congratulate Alex Parker.
Yeah.
He is now a certified floodplain manager. He passed that state test. And it's a hard one.
Yeah.
It's hard. So, good job.
Yes, thank you. Any of the commissioners have any comments or any input, anything that y'all are dealing with that maybe the subdivision committee needs to talk about?
It just looks like y'all put in a lot of work.
Yes, thank you.
Anyone present have any comments? Sheriff?
So one of the things we looked at, that we've had some issues from some of the other ones, if you at some point would get us in front of the committee, we're trying to come up with a uniform, making the developers use Texas's uniform traffic control literature so that the signage is correct. It hurts us on the back end from the enforcement standpoint. I'm not able to enforce traffic laws, parking regulations and stuff if the signage isn't erected correctly.
Yeah.
If it's not the right size, if it's not the right height, if it's too far from the roadway, if it's blocked, if it's, there's a bunch of things that go in that. So there is a manual in Texas as far as uniform traffic devices control, the right way to do a sign, the right way to put up a stop sign, the right height, and does it have contrasting colors? The other part is naming of the streets. We would encourage the committee to put that cost on the developer so that the county is not having to go out and erect street signs and make street signs and put labels. Let's push that over to the developer. If he's going to develop that land, let him have the street signs and have everything named prior to us accepting that, so you all are not having to go out, put up poles and buy metal and supplies to build that. So
they do currently.
Is that required?
Yes.
Okay. The one thing that we're seeing between some of the developments, and some of them are in the cities, is there's not a uniform style. So you may have a speed limit sign that's 8 inches by 12 in one area, and you may have one that's 2 foot by 2 foot in another area. Believe it or not, there is a right way, there's a legal way,
mm-hmm.
and we can enforce that. If I write you a ticket for speeding and you contest that, one of the things that you can contest is that the government agency didn't place the sign at the proper distance or the proper point, or it wasn't the right size, or it didn't have contrasting color. If you can somehow or another include that in your discussion, it would help us then be able to respond when y'all get complaints. It lets us to go out and be able to do that legally. So
okay.
If you can add that.
We do have that in there. I just didn't include it in the notes, but I would like for you to come and talk to us and make sure that we have all of it.
Perfect. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Good deal. Anybody else?
And thank you for the committee members that are here and the ones that are not here. Y'all have done a great job, and thank you for everything you're doing for Hardin County.
Ditto. Yeah, thank y'all. Y'all have some of the, you're engaging some of the cities about this as well, right?
Yes.
Just making sure.
The city of Koontz has been the most involved, but we have, we've invited all of the cities. A couple of them haven't come, but I've been in contact with them.
Good deal. And y'all are just making sure that we don't do anything that conflicts with what they have going on if we have a development close to one of the city limits.
Correct, yes. Right. And we do have a lot of language in the ETJ, how that would work. It would be the most stringent. But I think ours is going to be the most strict now.
Okay, good deal. Anything else? Mr. Cook, did you want to invite the gentleman up?
Yeah, that's fine. It's kind of ironic because what he was just talking about is what we had conversation this morning about. But this is Raymond Belk, one of the most recent conference that I went to. I had the opportunity of meeting him. He's with the, it's an organization that's been funded through the state and also on the federal side to do training for cities and counties for road and bridge. Anyway, he's been here the last 2 days meeting with the commissioners and providing some options for us for training of our people as well as other people in the county. But anyway, I asked him if he could step in today and at least introduce himself and tell us a little bit about what he does.
Could you start with what the sheriff just talked about?
Absolutely. I'll introduce myself again. My name is Ray Bell. I'm a consultant for the University of Texas at Arlington. Specifically, the program that I work with is called the Texas Local Technical Assistance Program. It is a TxDOT and Federal Highway Administrator program, grant funded. It's been around 38 years. It's not going away. It is legislatively mandated at the federal and state level. To address the comments that the sheriff made yesterday, I had the opportunity to meet with three of your commissioners in separate meetings. Commissioner Kirkendall and I were going to be relaying some information also. But one of the things that I did talk about was the Texas manual on uniform traffic control devices. I'm retired from TxDOT. I ran the workforce development program for 10 years, and then I was a senior project manager for several years before retiring in But we bring a series of training events to counties and cities across the state of Texas for no cost. You're never going to pay an invoice, okay, because it is grant funded. We do several different classes on the MUTCD, and we also do them on sign erection and things like that. We had conversations specifically about those issues. And you're absolutely correct, Sheriff. You know, yeah, you can buy out of the magazine the 8x12 speed sign, but guess what? It's not MUTC compliant, so therefore it's not enforceable. It also places the county at risk if it's on a county road, if an accident happens, because litigation does arise quite often out of those types of issues. So we bring that information into your road and bridge crews to take advantage of that information. We provide just not the training, but we provide a vast array of resources with all of our training events that we bring to you also. And again, we come to you, you don't come to us, the instructors come here, it's a live class. We do a scaled down copy of the Texas Manual on Uniform Traffic Control Devices. The whole manual is about this thick, it's over 900 pages, but we teach about this much of the counties, because typically your county roads are 400 ADT or less. So we teach what you need to do to make your workers safe in the work zone, flagging requirements, signage requirements, et cetera, et cetera. Based on interviews that I did yesterday, I developed a document in what I call a training matrix and gave to the commissioners. I sent that out by email last night to them. And it's a four-year training program for the road and bridge folks. And it puts them through a series of traffic, safety, core skills like heavy equipment operations, some online training that they can take advantage of for no cost also to the university. It's to them at this point to review. I've got some tentative dates that I've sent Commissioner Ernie about where we could come down and do a kickoff with all the road and bridge folks. I've done this program since retiring for right around 60 counties now across the state of Texas. Next week I'm going to be out working with Terry County, Yoakum County, and Lubbock County. So I'm all over the place a lot like this. There's 40 like me. Most of us are retired TxDOT. Or we teach the classes and anything that has to do with, you know, technical operations, et cetera, we do that. We also do a series of management classes and project management. And we open those classes up to other county folks also, you know, from the sheriff's office, tax assessors, collectors. We do basic supervision, we do management conflict in the workplace. And the new one we're getting ready to kick off is the employee evaluations. And I didn't have that conversation with you yesterday. I don't know if you're doing them here in Hardin County yet. Some counties do, some don't. Some departments do in the counties, others don't. But it's an opportunity is what it is. One of the things that I also delivered to the commissioners, and that I did a presentation at the VG Young Conference, has to do with attracting and retaining public works employees. It's a special program we're doing right now. We kicked it off 2 weeks ago. And it's resource information and documentation and how we can come on site and help you if you're having problems with that, because it tends to be a problem within the state of Texas, along across the nation, getting good quality applicants. And then once you get them in here, do we keep them, and how do we keep them? So I'll take any questions you may have.
One question I have is, you're talking about road and bridge. Do you offer anything to any of the other departments, any type of training?
Because our money comes from highway, mm-hmm. Okay, TxDOT internally to the state and federal, the core focus is always on road and bridge personnel or transportation infrastructure. We can go out of those boundaries a little bit from time to time. We can pull in things like drainage because it's infrastructure related, parks and rec, stormwater, anything that's related to that. We do some actual classes also that are TCLO certified for what we call traffic control response for first responders. You know, so that would bring in your EMS, the sheriff's department, and things like that. So we're kind of narrow in that scope, but we flex it as much as possible.
Right. Sounds like an excellent program. We sure appreciate you bringing it to us.
Yeah, one of the things that really impressed me with it first was the cost. You know, it's zero. But two,
yeah, I love that.
But two, I mean, it helps the employees develop, you know, and that helps morale. It also helps them work safe. I know whenever I was here before, was on the safety committee, and there was a lot of workman comp claims come out of the road and bridge, along with the sheriff's office. So you know, if we can help them work safe, it helps us in other ways, but it also helps them develop, provides our citizens with better skilled operators.
Right.
We work very closely with Texas Association of Counties, TAC, and especially with the risk managers. And they tell us that's where the majority of the working comp claims come from, is from Sheriff's Department or in Bridge. And so, you know, we're not in competition with each other. We're always, they'll refer us to things and we'll refer them, you know, to counties a lot of times. But yeah, it's about making a safe work environment, the morale, have them go home the way, the shape they came in to work, and personal development and career development, you know, getting to stay with, you know, come to Hardin County, make it a career, stay with y'all. So,
It's a win-win-win. Yeah. That's it.
Commissioner Kirkendall, I'll be reaching out to you later on. I'm going to hit the road. I live in Bell County, so I got a little drive ahead of me. And
well, thank you for coming.
Okay.
We appreciate
thank
you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
All right, we'll move on to item 3B. Update from the committee on proposed changes to the personnel policy manual. Ms. Harrington, you want to sit at one of these tables?
I think it would probably be easier that I can write things down if anybody has any questions or concerns.
Yes, ma'am.
Where do you want to start with the?
I think we'll just kind of start with number one on the list that the committee's kind of been going through. This has been out, sent out to all of the elected officials and department heads to just kind of let you know what the committee was talking about. I've been able to make each of the meetings, and I think we have 9 people that serve on the committee, and most of them have been able to attend each meeting, and we appreciate all of the input. Some of the elected officials and department heads have also provided us some input as well. And we have addressed all of those. So you want to just start with number one about background checks?
It was the recommendation by the committee that we implement background checks and possibly drug screening. We already do this for our road and bridge personnel. A lot of this, you can imagine, there's an example that I gave the committee. We had somebody apply for, it was either the auditor's office or the treasurer's office, and there's a section on our application that asks, do you have anything higher than a Class B misdemeanor? And one lady put that she had been in trouble for forged checks or for writing hot checks, one of the two. Well, if that wasn't written on the application, we would have never known. So I highly suggest that we do that. Most everybody that works in the county works with money. I mean, they're privileged to a lot of confidential information. So that's why. One of the things that I had suggested, I did get with the sheriff on the background checks. They can do those for less than $10. And I know when I send the road and bridge employees down to do drug testing, it's about $25. So you would, the prospective employee would be looking at paying about $35. I don't think that's too much to ask to have a job. I know anybody that goes to work for the school district, they have to pay for fingerprinting and a background check and drug screening, and I think, I want to say it's around $50. Does anybody have any questions about that?
I don't agree with if we selected them, interviewed them, of having them pay the cost. I think the county should bear that burden.
I think it's
industry standard that most once you hire somebody that they pay for that. No, we wouldn't make every applicant pay for that. Once you narrow it down to the person you're going to hire, then they pay for the background costs. If anybody else has input on that, we'd love to hear it. But I just know that talking to others, they don't cover that cost.
Do the other counties around the state?
I know for sure Chambers County does, and I believe Jasper County does.
Most every county does. And this would not include the road and bridge employees. I'm not trying to change that, what we do for them. That's included in y'all's budget now. This is just for other employees. The sheriff's department already does that. It's mainly, I guess, the tax office, county clerk, district clerk, you know, things like that.
Is it reimbursable if they pass it?
That can be up for discussion. I personally don't think the county should have to foot the bill for that. because I don't think $35 is too terribly much. If you are looking to get a job, I don't see where that would be a problem. Like I said, school districts don't reimburse you. Even if you want to go become a substitute teacher, which is a temporary, well, sort of temporary position, you're responsible for that cost. And like I said, I don't think the county should have to bear that burden because it's not a high amount.
I know that maybe counties do implement that, but in my past experiences and work history, I've never had to foot the bill for that type of thing because a background check is a liability for the company. So they're assuming responsibility whether or not they're going to hire that person, so they're doing a background check on that person to see if they're a qualified individual. But of course, again, that's up to the court.
Well, I tend to agree with you. I think that should be our burden, not theirs. And maybe something that would be refundable. If they pay it initially, show their commitment, but once they're hired, then we refund them that money in their first paycheck.
I like that idea.
And Sheriff, y'all do this now with background?
We do, Judge.
And do you pay them back?
Here's the exception. Because we're a law enforcement entity, we can run the criminal background check in-house through that. People who are not coming into work into those lines of, are not going to be, county's not going to be able to do that. Can't use criminal database
right.
For employment if it's not employment in a criminal justice agency. So I'll pick on the clerk's office for a month. I'm going to go work in the clerk's office. I can't use those resources to check the background. All I can do is check locally in Hardin County public records. Have they ever been to jail? One of the things that we had talked about on the background is if you put that, in order to make that prospective employee provide you with a copy of their criminal history, they're the only person that can run that. So they run it, they have to pay the tab. HR does not have the ability to go run that criminal history, the public one, off the website because they need your information and a way to do that. In other words, somebody else can't run yours. You have to run your own. So that was kind of the thought process when we talked about if there are companies out there that will do research and background, but that's a subscription cost to the county for doing backgrounds, and they're looking at what's publicly available. You would almost have to go the route what you're saying of they pay up front, and then you reimburse them if they hit some milestones or, you know, whatever. It is unique on our side because we can use the established criminal database, and then we require them to pay for their own drug screen, state mandated on their license. We require them to pay for their own physical, state mandated on their license. We pay, the county pays for the psychological. That's the big ticket item there. Right now they're $250 a piece, and that's a discount. So we pay the big ticket item, but we do push the fingerprints, the drug screen, and the physical too. And you are correct, not everybody does that. It's only when we make a conditional job offer. So not every prospective employee is having to have that outlay. It's just those that are chosen for employment. And that it right now it's not refundable. I have no revenue to be able to pay. You know.
Do they choose their own doctor?
Yes, we let them. We give them the forms that have to be signed, and who can legally sign off on the form, and they can go to their doctor, their RN, their PA, their nurse practitioner, whoever they want to go to for a physical, and whoever they want to go to for a drug screen. We require the standard, what I call trucker's screen for DOT, which is a 11 panel, 14, 17 panel drug screen. It usually runs about $20 to $30 on the drug screen, and the family physician a lot of times will do their physical in conjunction with that. But yeah, that's the one hurdle that when she had asked and we talked about the background is we can only do the background through the criminal justice system if they're coming into a law enforcement corrections job. It doesn't apply to other folks in the county north to Broken Bridge. So you're kind of at the mercy of, okay, where do you want to get that data? And how do you know if you're getting good data? If I move here from Illinois and I'm going to come to work, how do you know that I'm not some really bad person that doesn't need to be working in public government? Right now, you don't.
So, Sheriff, what's that process? So you get ready to hire somebody, you say, I need to, well, you can run it, but let's just say in the clerk's office.
Yeah.
So say we need a criminal background check done on them, where do we send them?
You can do a couple of options. She's identified, and I'll give her some resources, the state website. She can hand them a piece of paper that has the link on it. They log in. They have to be at a computer that has a printer. They log in, they upload their credit card information. It hits them for $8, $10, whatever it is, and they push print. And they print it out, and then they bring it back to her and say, I'm providing you with my criminal history. Here it is. And then whatever, that's the easiest. Now, there's other software companies that do computerized background checks that go look at all the public data, you know, that's out there, that if the county wanted to do that on the front end, you could engage that subscription, pay for a yearly subscription for ever how many inquiries you wanted, and she could sit at her desk and she could run an inquiry and research all the public data and include that as one of the review processes. So it kind of gives you a little bit of either way if you want to push the cost to the employee or if you wanted to do it in-house.
Ms. Holland?
We have filings in our court that for adoptions and things where the person adopting the child has to go for a criminal background check. They go down, they have their fingerprints done, and that goes to the DPS. DPS sends us a report of whether or not they have anything outstanding.
Is that a place in Beaumont they go to?
Yes.
Have on Cardinal Drive or somewhere?
Maybe?
I don't remember the address.
Okay.
Is that Denver?
Yes, okay. I'm going to go.
Just past Saltgrass on the access road.
That's what we use for juvenile probation because we're required by law to have their fingerprint and background check ran. So we send them down there, make them an appointment. And the ones that do not get hired do not get reimbursed.
But if they're hired,
we reimburse it because we put that in our that's in our budget.
What kind of time frame turnaround is there? Because I know in some offices you're trying to get people in there as soon as you can.
That's less than a week.
Do you happen to know the cost?
I believe it's $25.
And that's who we use as well. They have some fingerprints for us as well. We don't roll them anymore. Nobody does the. We use the exact same place.
And we do as well if they're issuing birth certificates out of my office. They have to do that now. Used to not have to, but now there's only certain people in the office that can issue birth certificates.
Do y'all reimburse them for their checks?
County paid for them.
Okay.
Has anyone looked into the cost of a subscription service? Because, you know, from my experience, that's what we've used in other companies that worked at. Is it?
I've got a few friends and family members that have gone to work at industry and things like that, and they all go to that same place you just talked about, and they have to pay for it, and they don't get reimbursed for it. But they're not counties, and they're not school districts, they're not cities. It's
what's the average wage that y'all pay in your department, Monica?
The average wage?
Yeah, hourly wage.
Detention is
$15. Okay. See, my thing would be depending on what we're paying them. You have someone working $15, $17 an hour, they might not can afford that out of pocket.
Mine's more along the lines of we need to all get on the same page and do the same thing for everybody.
Yeah, I agree with that.
If we're already paying for it in some departments, I guess we need to figure out a way to cover it for all of them if we're going to do this. And I would say, my opinion is if we're going to pay for it, that we reimburse them until they make probation.
I agree with that.
That's my thought.
Correct.
Yeah, oh yes, ma'am. Yeah, we wouldn't want everybody to have to go through that.
After 90 days, right?
Yes, sir. Any other talk on that? All right, Ms. Harrington. Number two. I guess I'm supposed to be showing the slides too, aren't I?
I think our slides are out of order of the what we've typed up.
But let's just go over here. Okay. I don't know that everybody's going to be able to see that, but.
We wanted to change the workers' comp policy. It was sort of vague, and it said, I know y'all probably cannot read the highlighted area there, but that the employee shall be required to notify his or her department head or the human resources department as soon as possible.
That's the current policy.
Yes, that's the current policy. I'd prefer to change that. I wanted to get the workers' comp claims in sooner so that way we can make sure that if somebody did suffer an injury, it was due to work-related injury or illness. So we updated that. I did have Ms. Walton look over everything, and she agreed with it. Well, she helped me revise it some too. But now it will say, shall fill out an incident report and notify his or her department head in the Human Resources Department within 24 hours of injury or illness. If the injury or illness occurs during non-regular county business hours, the incident must be reported by 10 a.m. the following business day. In the event these procedures are not followed by the employee, it could result in the loss of and or denial of workers' compensation benefits. The employee could also face disciplinary action. And I think, as I pretty much stated, it's just to make sure we get those worker comp claims in a timely manner. Does anybody have any questions about that one? Or
the only thing I have is, you know, notify your department head immediately, no later than 24 hours. Because I know personally, I've got a worker, and they think they've injured themselves on the light right now.
That... it says within 24 hours.
Right. So here's my question. So I've got someone on a shovel at 1 o'clock today. Twins is back, but he's got through tomorrow at 1 o'clock to tell me. So I don't find out about it till lunch the next day, when maybe I could have investigated it, seen if there's any witnesses, if it's immediately, because a lot of times what I'll do, I'll pull them off, and if there's something I can give them that's less strenuous for the day, I'll do that so they can finish the day out. Of course, we fill out the paperwork and then ask them, do they want to go? And we have them sign off on that. So I would want to know immediately.
I have a policy in my department. I will know immediately.
Right, and I do too. I just didn't know if it would conflict with what's written.
Well, we could change it to say notify the department head immediately and Human Resources within 24 hours.
Okay.
If you're going to fill out a first report of injury, I just think that should go to HR within 24 hours. That way, if she starts getting claims from doctors, it's known.
I agree.
And if any other type of assistance or something needs to be provided, she can get that to you.
Because we still have them sign the waiver, correct, that we use a certain company? Yeah.
Well, actually, because we're a part of an alliance with TAC, there is a list, and they can actually choose the doctor that they, or I guess the facility that they want to use, but we always recommend the ones that we use because we get the information back quicker. Right now, we have East Texas Urgent Care and AFC Urgent Care. Those are two that we use all the time. We've really started leaning more towards East Texas. They're a lot better about seeing our employees faster, getting the information to us faster, and things like that. But in all actuality, the employee does have a choice if they're on that list, if they accept our workers' comp.
So we can give them the list and say, here's who we prefer, they can get you in quicker.
Well,
the
packet that we give them, with, I think everybody pretty much knows they have a paper that they have to sign saying that we are a part of that alliance, and there's a web address on there. Most employees, though, come and say, where am I supposed to go? They really don't look on there, but they do have that option if they choose.
Is that good if we make that change to the language? Notify the department head immediately? And notify the resources within 24 hours after the injury? Okay. Anybody else have any comments about that? That meets all of our legal. There's nothing illegal about changing that. The two legal eagles?
Correct.
All right. Thanks.
And the next one is a mandatory 2 weeks notice upon separation. A lot of this is the norm. Whether any other county you work at, private industry, it is always required to give a 2 week notice or you do not get your pay for your benefits. Like your vacation hours. It could even include holidays if we wanted to go that route, but mainly vacation. I don't think I've seen in a very long time anybody that is not required a 2 week notice upon separation. This gives the department head or elected official more time to find another employee, so there's not that big gap in there. Also, I think it would help out for the department head or elected official if you know somebody's leaving, but you don't want to be without them, you can go ahead and let them off then, and let them be off for the 2 weeks and not have to wait for them to work and then pay them out, say, 2 weeks of vacation. Does anybody have any questions or suggestions on that?
Is that legal?
It is. If it's in your policy, it is.
What if they were let go?
Then you don't have to pay them anything. Because vacation, holiday, sick, the only thing that is not a benefit that we have on our books is the comp time. Everything else is a benefit of the county. In all honesty, if the court wanted to vote right now and say, hey, we don't want to give anybody vacation, holidays, sick leave, or anything, we're not required by law to do
that. Oh, don't even bring that up.
Y'all might not have any employees left, but...
So my question is, I love this, but do we have a problem with people leaving without a 2 week notice?
Sometimes we do. People just walk in and say, hey, I'm quitting.
Or just text you and say, I'm not coming in anymore.
Yeah, or you don't hear from them. But then we're still required to pay them out, you know, all their holiday hours, their vacation time they have on the books, things like that. In the long run, it could save the county money. And then you also end up with hopefully more responsible employees that say, hey, I don't want to lose all of this time, so I'm going to be courteous and let my supervisor know, you know, I found another job. And really, I think it helps in the long run, because most of the time everybody posts jobs for at least 2 weeks trying to get good candidates in here, and you have to go through the interview process along with paying them out. So.
And this is really not being done to try to not pay somebody their vacation. It's really being done to make people more courteous towards their department head and let them know, give them some notice before they leave.
Right.
And the carrot is to make sure that they know that if they don't do it, they'll lose their benefits.
Yes.
Any other discussion on that?
This one's going to be a hot topic. I guess, can we do this one before we do the comp time? How much do we? I guess we'll go ahead and start with it. The holiday accrual, we've really been going back and forth on ideas for the comp time. I think everybody pretty much knows that. So one of the things that I came up with, and I looked at other counties' policies, they don't allow their employees to accrue their holiday time. They pay them out at straight time. So that way it sort of takes that bank away, and then it will give them more opportunity to use their comp time. It will put an increase in the department's budget. The ones that do accrue the holiday time now, that they're not having to pay that out. But like I said, this was sort of goes with the comp time, a pitch to be able to use the comp time more often than not. Holiday hours accrue a lot, especially for really not in Road and Bridge so much, but the other employees that work 410s, and then, of course, in the Sheriff's Department. So if an employee does leave, you're looking at paying out a lot more time, along with the comp time and the vacation hours. So this is sort of just a suggestion, and I would love to hear anybody's thoughts on this. I have not gotten with Candace about what it would cost if we paid employees out straight time. I know a lot of times Road and Bridge does it. Whenever y'all have a holiday on a Thursday or a Monday, the people will come in and work and still, you know, work their 40 hours. So we're paying them out their holiday hours at straight time versus overtime. But anybody's ideas or thoughts on this? Or
I just want to add, you didn't want to ask Candace to put that together until we saw how everybody felt about it. If it looks like the consensus is to do this, then you're going to ask her to put that together.
My thing is...
Oh, go ahead, Candace.
Just to keep in mind that your holidays do expire, so if you don't take them within a year, then you lose it. So then the county's not out money at that point in time, only if the employee separates from the county. Maybe shorten the time period of when you can use your holiday. I don't know if that would be a benefit.
We talked about that as well, but I'm going to talk about the sheriff's office because I know that situation. They they already lose a lot of holidays and what have you because they don't have time to take them. So I think it'd just be better if we paid them. That was my opinion on it.
Well, I did look at kind of what we had at 9:30, what balances were in those banks, and like Melinda said, most of the departments were those departments that work shift work. The sheriff's office, the jail, dispatch, adult probation, those places. But I did also notice within those departments, there were just a handful of people that made up about half of the balance that they had. So I don't know if it's positions or job responsibilities those people hold or what. Maybe there needs to be something looked at on the department level.
When you looked at it, did you look at their holiday hours versus their comp time? Because one thing I noticed a lot of is people either have a lot of comp time or a lot of holiday hours. They sort of work hand in hand because they're going to take one or the other, and 9 times out of 10 they're taking their holiday hours because their comp hours don't expire. And I don't know, I mean, what do you think that your department, how would they feel about being paid out their holiday hours versus banking them?
I think they would be okay with that. The issue comes for me, for all the shift work, the issue is going to come down to the hot button. What do you do when the employee is scheduled his regular day off and it falls on a holiday? That's the biggest issue. And until we get an answer for that, that's really what everybody's watching to see what's going on. And what I'm saying, the contrast is, if I'm a traditional 5-8 employee and the holiday falls on either a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, or Friday, and I work here in the courthouse, we take that day off. So this is never an issue to those employees. But for an employee who's off on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, and Good Friday is Friday and it's a holiday, that employee is on his regular day off. How do you compensate him for that holiday? So you either, right now they gets he banks 8 hours, 11 hours, 12. He banks whatever the daily rate is for what he works. So if he's a 12-hour guy, he puts 12 in the holiday bank and he has to use that within a year. That's going to be the issue if you go to payout. If you say, hey, we're not going to bank any time, we're going to pay you. Now what works is if I'm on my day off and that holiday falls and I'll say Good Friday, you're going to be paying 8 hours, or for that deputy, it's 12 hours. You're going to be paying 12 hours of holiday pay to him because that was his day off. If he works it, you're going to be paying him for working, and you're going to be paying him another 12 hours because that's the holiday. So now he's a double-time guy. And if he's made his 86 hours already, now he's double-time and a half for that day. He's no longer paid at straight time. He's paid at time and a half because he's over. That's the sticking point on the holiday for us. I don't think my staff really minds one way or another on how, whether it's banked or whether it's paid. Sure makes it easy on everybody if it's paid, but you're talking a good chunk of money there too. Number one, to pay it down, you know, and then go cash forward. But I think it's for us and for anybody else who is the shift worker, it's if you're off that day, how do you compensate that employee? You're going to pay them for the holiday, and then if they have been working, they're going to basically get paid twice.
Well, they have to work to get paid.
No. If it falls on their day off, everybody else gets
it. It's a holiday pay is what it is.
Yeah.
So if
everybody else gets
not,
the holiday. But that guy's on his day off, so he doesn't get anything.
We just count it a blessing to be off on a holiday.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. But that is the issue, is that it falls on your RDO.
Didn't we look at the other county policies to see how they handled that?
That's what most of them, they either bank the holiday or they pay straight time. And we could even
but
go.
But if they're already off that day, how do they handle it? I mean, if it falls on their day off, how's that handled?
They still pay them straight time. And even if they do work that day, they still pay them straight time because it's holiday pay.
Straight time twice.
But if they work, then that can go into overtime. But it's sort of like how Road Bridge does. And one thing, and this is just a suggestion we could do,
thank
anybody
you,
that works that holiday, maybe we bank that holiday but pay the one that's off the straight time or vice versa.
We could cover
so that way
rest.
We sort of work half and half. I don't know. Because
yeah,
I think it could get pretty costly, but we can't say, well, just because you're off, you don't get that holiday. So we're like I said, a lot of this goes into with the comp time. If we can figure out the comp time, then we don't even have to do this, but it was just a suggestion.
Can we have a holiday committee to see if we have too many holidays? Because what is it, 14 or 15?
14 is what we have, yeah.
And we're actually missing one that...
Some counties have 15 or 16. Yep. Mm-hmm. Some counties have 12.
And it doesn't affect every department. Not really.
Correct.
It's just
not like y'all.
Separate.
Yes, I agree.
The, yeah,
like
work.
Yeah,
yeah,
it's just
other than Saturday and Sunday off.
Yeah.
It's really mainly just shift work. I mean, at 9:30, at the end of the prior fiscal year, we had 3,262 hours.
And I think we talked about we wouldn't be paying those off. Whatever day the new policy starts, we would start paying those holidays then. They would still have them in their bank to use before the 12 months was up.
And that's just a handful of departments.
How many again?
3,262 hours. I mean, I don't know what it is right now, but that was at 9:30. I'm sure it's different now.
What do y'all think?
Sheriff makes a great argument, and so I would defer to those departments who have that issue, because I'm sure it's a morale issue.
And when you're talking about pay, you're only talking about upon separation.
Mm-hmm. No, they get paid during the pay period.
Yeah, yeah.
I could support either one.
Why don't we put it in there? You got to take a day for a holiday, take a day instead of getting paid.
I think
that's
what
it's issue,
currently.
It is. They're having the issue of having enough staff for them
all.
Because of comp time,
if a holiday falls on your off day, you don't get it.
That's the way we were always treated with state when I worked with state.
That's not popular.
I'd venture to tell you it's not legal. you can't compensate one. I can't pay you to stay home and give you 2 days off that week, Saturday and Sunday, but not do the same thing for my shift worker.
I bet it's legal.
What?
Okay, so let me remake the argument then. So if I work Monday through Friday,
right,
if I'm a 5'8 guy, and I take Good Friday, you're going to pay me to be off on Friday, and you're going to give me a Saturday and Sunday off. If I'm a shift worker, and I work Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, and my days off are Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday, I get 4 days off only.
Mm-hmm.
Where's my work day that I get off like every other county employee?
So it would have to be Monday, but then you would have to bring in somebody else.
Exactly.
And that's going to
make that's what led to the committee's
so
discussion of, are you robbing from Peter to pay Paul? Because if you go to all cash and your minimum staffing, and now I've got to pay somebody to come in and cover that shortage on a shift.
I think it's a very good benevolent policy. We have very good fringe benefits that a lot of people don't.
You're right. You're 100%. I agree with you 100%. It's a stickler, and I do think that we are headed in the right direction of getting away from banking time. Anything we can do to get away from banking time helps us on the back end on separation. It helps us on these larger payouts. They can burn some time. They give a 2-week notice, and they've got 4 weeks of vacation on the books, and they burn two of those. You know, if you're able to let them off for those last 2 weeks, it sure helps that capital outlay that's going there.
Sure.
But unfortunately, on the shift work side and the departments that have minimum staffing, I can't afford to give everybody that day off. I mean, I can't tell every deputy, hey, it's Good Friday, it's a holiday, everybody stay home.
Yeah.
I mean, I've got to have people there. So you've got to do some, same with the jail, same with juvenile, dispatch. Dispatch, for as far as I know, has been doing that since day one, correct? They don't bank any, because they're all on a cash basis.
Yeah,
they all bank holidays.
Yeah,
they holidays?
They
even
have
the ones that are on the cost share with the cities?
yes. I don't know if they have much.
They bank theirs. They bank theirs based on their hours that they worked that day or what they would have worked. Because they work different hours depending on which day of the week it is. So, but they all bank them.
I had noticed, and that is a great argument, have to abide by the rules. But I have noticed on this comp time stuff, it's the same people that keep building it up time after time. I don't think that's necessary as far as comp time. I ain't talking about holidays. But I see where you're coming from on the holiday, where that.
Yeah. On the just on the holiday hours, if a patrol deputy banks all their holidays throughout the year, there's 14 holidays at 12 hours of holiday, that's 168 hours. And then if he or she were to quit or separate, we do have to pay that out. Otherwise, they do get to take the time off. Or after that 12 months, if they don't take it, they lose it. If they take it, one deputy takes that 168 hours throughout the year, he's got to usually, not always, I'm not speaking for how you run your schedule, but if there's already somebody off and somebody tries to take off, he's got to fill it, so that then creates the comp time or overtime. So
it seems like to me, I mean, it's, you're going to have to pay it. I mean, because it just creates another problem.
It's just,
I mean, you
time.
Fix one problem, you create another problem.
Yeah.
So right now they have a year to use the holiday time or they lose it.
Mm-hmm. So we're not out the money.
And comp time rolls over.
We're only out money if they separate or get terminated and they fall in that right. I mean, the maximum will be 168 hours if it fell in that right time frame where it didn't expire and no other holidays accrued. That would be the worst case scenario. The other option is we're creating pay through comp time because the sheriff's having to bring in, especially in the jail, he has to have, you know, we all know he has minimum staffing there.
Mm-hmm.
If somebody burns a holiday and he's short in the jail, he's got to bring somebody in. So we are paying for it as comp time for that person instead of holiday for the person that took off.
Did y'all in the committee figure out, I think Mark had said prior to the committee being formed that it was illegal to require them to take comp before they take holiday. Did y'all determine that is illegal? If we as a county required them to take their comp before their holiday?
I don't think that it's illegal. I have not checked into that. I will have to for sure. But again, vacation, sick, and holiday hours, personal days, all of that, that's a benefit. So if we want, I'm not 100% sure, but if we require them to take their comp time before their benefit hours, then I think that we could do that. I just think that we probably have a lot of mad employees because they don't, because they'll end up losing their vacation.
Mm-hmm.
But,
I could see that. We have a lot of mad citizens in Hardin County that every time we pay out comp, it's $150,000 or $200,000 or whatever it is too. So you know, we as a court have to weigh that in as well.
I agree. That was the reason for trying to maybe pay the holiday out straight time, trying to come up with a way to, you know, minimize the comp. Another thing that we sort of talked about, but I don't think it was very popular, was lessening the amount of time they can use their holiday hours.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of going the full year.
I think that is a good idea. And then,
well, it used to be shorter, didn't it?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. What is 6 months?
90 days
or whatever. Maybe.
And because of the standards in the jails, how many people you have, they were just straight losing them because they could not take off. Physically could not take off.
Right.
Maybe 6 months.
This might not be feasible for the county either, but in your opinion, Sheriff, if we put more money in your overtime budget, would that help on the comp time?
You've got to have one or the other. You've either got to have more money on the overtime or you got to have more bodies on the shift. And unfortunately, throwing money into the overtime budget, at some point, your employees are going to lay down.
Yeah.
I mean, they're just going to say, hey, I'm tired. I'm not coming to work on my day off. I'm sick. I don't feel good. I've had an adult beverage. They're gaming that system of, and right now we go for volunteers, which is why you see certain employees with a high comp balance, is because they go, hey, you bet, I'll work it. Yeah, you bet, I'll work it. Yes, it's a short term, and we did that the last term or two of the budget, of adding more money in there, but at some point you got to have the bodies, because if they can't take off because you're at minimum staffing, and you give them off so they won't lose it, now you got to go over here and pay this guy that's on his day off to come in and cover the shift for them.
So this is not a very good question to ask a department head, but how many people in the jail right now you wanted new people that would eliminate half of your comp time? If you was asking us for personnel, how many would you say if we gave you that would eliminate half of your comp time?
Half a dozen.
That'd be a good round number. I'd tell you average about 1.5 per shift. So, you know, you're looking at, that's six people. That would help a bunch, a real bunch. Because let's be honest, we know there is a top number to 196 inmates in that jail. Okay, so let's just say we were, for argument's sake, we were at that level with inmates. You can do the math. One guard for every 48 inmates, plus one in the picket and one on the third floor. Those are your two extras that you have to have. So per shift. So that tells you the most that legally you would have to have. You know, that'd be the very least, I guess is a better way to say that.
And that's six, right?
That you would have, yeah. And so
six on days and six on nights.
Yeah, and right now we have six on days and six on nights. But that's before sick out, comp time, holiday, training, you know, whatever. And we're finding ourselves down to three and four. And so now I'm having to reach over here and get somebody on their days off to cover, just to get me to what the state says, to have enough bodies on shift for that 12 hours. Ideally, if you could get enough bodies where you could afford to have people off and still have enough to run that shift, that's the sweet spot. That's where you'd like to be. So I guess to answer your question, to get us in there, you're looking at an average of probably a 1.5 to 1.8. I mean, I could do the math. But yeah, I would say if you said we've got two in a day shift position, so if you put one on every shift and two in the day shift positions, you're at six bodies. Yeah, I think you're real close to saying, short of some sick out of everybody having the flu on that shift, I think you'd be pretty good at really cutting down.
And we know what the cost is per employee, so you're saying six, so we can figure that out.
Yeah, you can come up with a number.
We're easier as far as us paying this comp time.
Yes.
Because you would be, you'd be what, $300,000 on a jailer? With six, $50,000?
That's about $370,000
per day. I would say 68 is a ballpark figure. Totally
three more.
It's evident with the people that we have on this committee, the knowledge and the brains that we have on this committee, and we're still discussing this comp time assessment, that it's not going to be simple to handle.
We ain't got there yet. It does fall hand in hand. They might as well tackle it. It can all be fixed with money. It's just a lot of money.
Yeah.
That's a lot.
What about shift rotation? Has that been looked at as far as like changing? I don't know. Like shift schedules, changing shift schedules. Do they work four on, four off? Is that the thing?
Yeah, they're four.
I don't know
four.
If that would be of any benefit. I'm coming from a household who has someone working shift work. So.
It's the cheapest way to cover the most time with the less amount of labor cost. Ernie was here, Logan was here. We've looked at doing an 8-hour shift, we've looked at doing a 10-hour shift, and you can get more with fewer employees by doing a 12-hour shift, which is why. Yes, it's a great benefit. The employee loves to have 4 days on, 4 days off. You know, yeah, you're earning it for 12 hours a day. Mm-hmm. But if I went to 3/8, the number of bodies that we would have to hire to staff those shifts, mm-hmm. I just don't think that's financially feasible.
Does anybody in our region run anything other than 12-hour shifts?
Beaumont PD. The cities, big cities do.
But not the counties.
Not that I'm aware of. They have some form, some are 410s, you know, but those are support staff, investigators, daytime guys, you know, actual answering patrol calls and in the jail, almost everybody has some form of a 10 or 12-hour shift. Yeah. Just because, again, it's the way to get more with less.
I remember when Judge Caraway was here, we talked about, and Ed was here, that the rural section of Jefferson County was about the same size as Hardin County. Is that right? But they have about double the people because of their tax base.
Yeah.
Much less workload.
They just don't have a bunch of calls. On the patrol side, their expenses are the jail.
Yeah.
Because of Beaumont Police and mid and South County, you know. their job of housing prisoners is just huge.
Yeah.
Their patrol guys, I'm not saying they're not busy, but they're nowhere compared to ours.
Right.
Because so much is covered by somebody's city police department down there.
Because I know my first year on the course to learn that, I was really surprised because you just think Jefferson County. Yeah.
Yeah, my deputy that leaves here and goes there, and I've had several, says, hey, man, I got a reprieve. Again, argument for another day. But, yeah, Mr. Cooper, you're right in that at some point do we look at, hey, how do we fix that problem? Is it throwing more money into a comp time or overtime budget? Is it throwing more money into actual bodies? Yeah, I mean, I think at some point you've got to address it. And the policy committee, really, I'll be honest with you, they've done a heck of a job because they have looked at a bunch of different angles and tried to say, hey, what's good for everybody? And unfortunately, you have those 40-hour employees, and you have those shift work. And sometimes what works for one group is just not going to work for the other group. And I'm not opposed to having some policies that are for this section of employee and this section of employee. You know, what may work for public safety may not be what works for an 8-to-5 staff employee here inside the courthouse.
I agree with that.
Also, too, I know you said that y'all aren't 4-on-4 off, but have y'all looked at doing a different type of scale? I don't know if it would be feasible for law enforcement, but going to like a DuPont schedule or something similar to that.
You're still basically working, I mean.
I just didn't know if it would change like your shift up to where people, when people took off, it wasn't so difficult for a fill-in.
I'm afraid, because the 4 days off in a row helps us at least somebody. I get 4 days off in a row. I can take a mini vacation. If I can't get my week off because we're shorthanded, I can at least have 4 days off in a row, and I'll call that a week. So that has kind of been an added benefit on the side of having that.
Can I say something?
Sure.
With the calls y'all have to make, sometimes it takes 4 days to get over it again.
Mm-hmm.
A bad wreck.
I agree.
Death inside of a house.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so they may be off, but they're not off because it's still rolling around.
That compared to what he was talking about a while ago with your larger departments like Beaumont, they have a critical incident. They have a privilege of going to the house right when that incident's over with.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas when we were on 4-on-4 off 12-hour shift, we went to the next call. I mean, you're right there, but.
I don't know that I'd see a big difference, you know, 2-on, 2-off, 1-on, 1-off, you know, how you split it up, I don't think it's really going to make sense.
But, I mean, they would have like 7 days off in a row, I didn't know if that would, you know.
You just have to be mindful of the 86 rule, you know, anything, because the way it is right now, I can really keep a tab on my time and a half, because there's only one time when they jump over that and it goes, and that's if they bust that 86-hour rule to go to time and a half. There's only 1 week how it falls that way, and that's if you work the first day of the pay period on a Sunday, you'll get 8 days in there.
Do we have any idea of what your comp time pay is annually? Like, just say if we paid it out, because we're at about $350,000 at six.
With a lot of help from Candace, I can come up with that number.
Actually.
Yeah.
Just give me a second.
Okay.
An average. Yeah.
Because if it's like $150,000, you're saving over $200,000.
Yeah. I got you.
So this is at 9:30, and this is for all the sheriff's offices, a dispatch, jail, deputies, $48,000.
That was, we had just paid out all that comp time a few months before.
Well, so we paid out comp time, but that was.
We did that in like March or April.
And we haven't seen. So,
and we didn't pay everybody. Some people didn't want to keep
those
on the books, and we allowed them to.
That's the issue, though. We haven't seen a decrease. So we had that payout, but it's pretty much stayed stagnant. So we haven't seen a decrease.
See, I would rather pay comp time and add it to each department's budget so that you're not having. I know for me, it's hard for me to really schedule comp time because I need everybody. It's kind of like sheriff's office.
I guess.
My precinct,
yeah.
I need all hands on deck.
I hear you saying that, and I guess you and I would probably disagree on that, but I don't think Road and Bridge should have comp time. on the books. I'm not talking about ever being available to us. I'm talking about on the books. We should be able to handle that or we wouldn't have any.
Yeah. And we try to do that.
I do agree with that.
We try to do that same thing too in that same pay period. What gets us is when you're at the very end of the pay period and you got to cover some shifts and you don't have time to say, hey, flex that off. Go home early tomorrow at 12. I owe you 4 hours.
Yeah.
If you're completed and you're a stopping point, hey, let's flex that off so I'm not having to pay that. Well, it's great with my day guys. I can do that with all my detectives. I can do that with my support staff, my evidence techs, secretarial, clerical. And I can do it with some of the deputies when I have everybody working. I can say, hey, we got a full shift. Stay home tomorrow because I owed you 12 hours overtime. And it's a wash. But when it's the very end of the pay period, or if one of your guys on a Friday, the end of the pay period week, he's called out for a tree in the road and he spends 2 hours out there working, he's either going to put him 2 hours overtime or 2 hours comp time, you know?
I guess what I should have said, it's easier for us to take care of it than it is for you to take
care of it. Oh, you're exactly right. Yeah.
I agree with that. Uh-huh.
But her 48,000 number, that's just a thumbnail of what's, if you paid out right now, to make that a true number, you're going to have to look throughout the year and see all those that did burn comp time.
Right.
To see what that number is too, because you got to add that in there. It's not just what's outstanding.
I'd like to see, I mean, not that I need to see it, but like a fiscal year, what a fiscal year
was. We can come
up with
that.
You know.
So we can look at everything that was taken, that was labeled as
for cost benefit analysis. I mean, really.
Yeah, that figure was just what was remaining at 9:30.
Yeah, I think if we're going to let, and I don't mean to say let, but it is let somebody take comp time and keep it banked, knowing that they're going to get paid by the end of the year, might as well pay them overtime, because that's what's going to happen. That's the end result.
I agree.
And you're paying them at current rate.
Right.
If you pay them now.
Yeah.
If you wait until they separate 7 years later, you have two choices legally. You either pay them at their current rate, or you pay them at an average of their last 3 years, whichever's highest.
Yeah.
And speaking with other treasurers, a lot of them do pay comp time September every year, clear the books before the raises are given. And, you know, whatever's on there, you get paid for, so you're not coming up against that, paying at a higher rate 7 years down the road. They do it every year. It's scheduled that they do that every year.
I know Jasper County does that, and they take it out of their fund balance to do it. I would rather see us put it in the budget because you got to be able to forecast that. I think that's the best way to do it.
You're saying pay overtime, not comp time.
Either do what she's saying, clear it out each September to make sure that you're paying them at the rate they earned it at, or pay overtime. If we just pay overtime and say no more comp time, we could do that.
That wouldn't be a bad idea. And I have personnel in my department that anytime they do get comp time, they don't want pay. So they take that option, but I think that would be a good idea, what you're saying. Because some people just want to bank the days.
Yeah.
So they can take more off, the ones that can take off.
Yeah. And I'll have a few instances where they got something coming up, so they work 3 or 4 Fridays to get a week off. And, you know, when we're not doing a project or something. But I would rather say we're not doing comp time anymore, we're just paying, because we do have a very liberal fringe benefit package. And just take that option away.
It may have to be different for the Sheriff's Department. They're the largest department, but they're also the most difficult with what's going on by law. They have to have coverage there. So the other departments, 8 to 5 Monday through Friday, it's not the same.
I don't see why other departments, as far as like admin 8 to 5 staff, couldn't, you know, if you have a special project going on anywhere, couldn't flex time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think departments, this is going to be controversial but not personal, I think departments that don't take a lunch shouldn't get comp time. If they're working straight 8 to 4 shift, they shouldn't be able to bank comp time. It's not personal, but we hear that from employees. That's a big morale buster, that there's departments with comp time and they only work 8 to 4 without a lunch.
controversial but not personal.
So my department's 8 to 4 hour lunch, and I'm very strict and do not want comp time. I feel like you should go to get your work done while you're there, and we owe that to the county. And if I have to, like Candace has said, if I have a trial coming up, we started coming at 9 to 5 instead of 8 to 4. You're still getting your time in. I'm not accumulating comp time. We're all getting our job done. It's just a matter of efficient management, in my opinion. Mm-hmm.
From a commissioner standpoint, thank you. Because that would help us in all ways.
I agree with that. I mean, from a normal standpoint, there are always some type of extenuating circumstances that can happen. But I think, I mean, you hit the nail on the head. In your situation, it's different. You're mandated by law on what you can have or what you're supposed to have. So that's different.
If those extenuating circumstances come up, maybe a department head should come to Commissioner's Court and say, can I get approval for this person to have comp time on those of us that are 8 to 5, not the sheriff's department? But maybe that should be a policy that get approval first before, you know. I feel like as an elected official, we have a policy in place where I'm elected official or not, we should all go by that policy. And if it's in place that there is no comp time, then there's no comp time. We don't have comp time in our office.
So. Yeah, and I would relegate that to HR and the judge.
Well, we always have comp time in my office because of elections.
Yes.
There's just no way to get rid of it.
Yeah.
Well, we have some in ours that work on the weekends when we have to have somebody there too.
Yeah, but we still have
it's
Tracy has
election fund.
But we're trying to make them. I'm trying to make them use it.
Y'all are 8 to 5, right?
And I don't know if y'all heard Ms. Cook, but she said the people in her office that work during elections are paid overtime out of the election budget, so I think we should look at doing the same for the county clerk.
Yeah, they'd be happy to get paid for it.
That'd be good. Are we done talking about the holidays?
Mm-hmm. I think
we want to see what that's going to cost and come back with that, or do we just want
to leave it? Me personally, I would leave it up to whatever the recommendation of the committee is. Y'all know what you're doing. Y'all are researching this stuff, so whatever y'all come to a conclusion with, I'll back it.
I agree.
Well, let's see what it would cost to pay the shift workers for their holiday time.
I agree.
And then we can decide from there. Y'all can decide from there. How's that? Do we want to go ahead and... that's not in our slides about the comp time. Let's just go ahead and address that since we talked so much about it, and let's try to make a decision on that.
I think so, because it's already a topic, and then we can get on to the other subject.
Let's see if I can find that. I may not have it. I'll send it to everybody. You got it? It's in the packets?
I guess.
Yeah.
It says comp time discussion at the top.
Yeah.
I don't have it to display on the screen, but first thing that we talked about was comp time must be used within 12 months. The year would start on 10-1. I kind of think what we kind of talked about today is maybe trying to budget to pay to make sure that it's paid by the end of the budget year. And now we did talk about capping comp time at 20 hours for all of the 8 to 5 people or all the regular, I keep saying regular employees and others. I hate to term it like that, but it's for the kind of how it is. So, and then those that work the shift work, public safety work, would have a higher cap. And we had kind of talked about 96 hours, but I'm not sure. We'd want to hear from the sheriff what he thinks about that. And then at the end of the year, of course, whatever's left, we could pay it out. We'd have to budget for that. What does everybody think about that? And of course, Sheriff, what do you think about the cap? 96 hours for jailers and deputies and dispatchers, anybody that works more than the 8 to 5.
So you're bound by fair labor standards and wage and hour board. It's 480 hours. If your county has a policy of allowing comp time,
law, you have to allow those public safety employees to accumulate up to 480. Now, there is a caveat in there that allows you as the employer to direct them to burn comp time, and those two are conflicting, and TAC's gonna tell you that there's a couple of court cases that are being waged right now to make the decision between who has the bigger upper hand trump card. But unfortunately, it is very crystal clear. If you allow comp time at your agency and you employ, I think it's five or more PSO, public safety, jailer, dispatcher, jailer or law enforcement, you have to allow a 4-H. So again, we're in this deal of from an administrative standpoint, would I like it lower so that there's not a big deal? Sure I would. Uncle Sam doesn't give me that right.
No, we don't want to violate the law,
so,
or become part of case law either.
Yeah, so I think your cap, unfortunately, is stuck. It is what it is. If you do comp time, you're going to have those that, now you may have those that voluntarily say, hey, yeah, if you'll give me the time, if you can afford me to be gone, I'd love to burn my comp time. I'll take off. But you're at minimum staffing, and if I do take off, you're going to have to pay somebody to cover for my shift. But as long as you're still allowing comp time, that employee can say, no, I want to accumulate up to 480, and the federal law allows me to do that. And they are correct. So that's the issue with PSO, with the public safety officers. There's your cap. All the rest of them, you can do that cap anything you want to.
All right. So how does everybody feel about that?
What was the statement?
I like the
20-hour comp for regular employees and whatever the federal law is for public safety officers.
Yeah, I'm all good with it.
Are they going to get paid for anything over 20 hours? Because
after they get over 20, the department head should start telling them they got to take off and burn it. Now, if they keep that on the books more than 6 months, it would have to come to commissioner's court.
Okay, because with elections, as many as we have,
yeah.
I mean, I'm trying to make them take it, but like Tracy and Alyssa, Tracy's got... did have 40. I don't know if she still does.
She's had first time a lot for Alyssa vote.
Yeah, but that's only because, you know, we've been making them take it.
Well, you got the election in March, so if they go over 20, do you feel like they could use or get it back down under 20 before the general election in November, which is a little over 6 months?
Well, it depends on the rules you put in place, that they must take that before they take vacation, or if they're sick, they have to take comp instead of sick, because if it's an option, they're taking sick, if they're sick.
Yeah, then we have
if they're sick, I don't think you can make them take vacation or time, right? I wouldn't think we'd want to, honestly. If they're sick, they should take the sick time. If they're out of sick time, they can use their other PTO.
And that's what they do. That was the whole point in the holiday thing. But I have a question, because it's only Brittany and I in my office. So for the other offices out there, and this is just the 8-to-5 workers, or, you know, the ones working 40 hours a week. I don't see where it would be an issue letting an employee have a 30-minute or longer than an hour lunch to kill that 30 minutes, or letting them off early 30 minutes. I think that there are a lot of ways to get this comp time off, and I will say, and I guess this is sort of more personal than it is professional, but as a taxpayer, I don't think that we should be paying anybody that works from 8-to-5 overtime.
Yeah, one of the things we're doing, because BB has so much vacation time, I think starting next week she comes in an hour late and leaves an hour early.
It's all about management. I mean, I do the same thing quite often. Alicia works through lunch with me in court, and I let her off at 4 o'clock that day or that Friday, whatever she chooses. Looks like Laura's going to work through lunch today, so by the end of this week, I'm going to make sure she gets to take that time off, and we just flex it out. It's all about management.
Yeah.
And what you can do.
Yeah, and I'm legally, if they work it, you have to pay them out. I don't think you have
that time and a half.
Mm-hmm. Yes. But if you can get it done within that pay period, you don't have to pay time and a half, or let them have an hour and a half for every hour they work.
Right. It's all about, like you said, management and flexing time. Mm-hmm.
Well, and any time that you're allowing comp time and they're not taking it during that same pay period, you have to give it to them that time and a half.
Mm-hmm. If our guys work 10 hours, they get 15.
Managed within that pay period somehow. You could do that by 30 minutes or 30 minutes been letting somebody be gone for 7.5 hours of a day when you need them there.
All right, so it seems like we're kind of on consensus on the cap. And what about item of the recommendation on number 3 about utilizing comp time before they're able to use the PTO? And it says sick on here, but I think we weren't supposed to put sick. Is that right?
I think we can look, that we should definitely look into that. I don't, like I said before, I don't think that would be a problem because vacation, sick, personal, holiday, and even funeral leave. That's something I don't even think we've talked about in the committee. All of those are benefits of the county. We're not required, the county is not required to give the employees that time.
Unless an employee is sick, my people have to burn their personal days first because it's a use it or lose it. And I've gotten, when I was first elected, not really realizing the system, you get down to the anniversary date and all of a sudden you got people off for 2 days because they haven't used them. So in our department, we try to burn personal days first, but if we did away with personal days, then we could do comp time.
After we finish comp time, we're going to talk about that.
If we, probably no commissioner wants to talk about this one, but I'll bring it up. If we do number 4, what's the alternative? We're going to put money in Mark's budget, in the sheriff's budget.
Budgets.
And juvenile probation. Eliminate comp time is number 4.
Put money in tax collector and
yes. That's the note I made. If we do away with it, we got a budget for it.
Right. And I don't know the number. I know that we kind of kicked around some numbers a while ago, but if I said eliminate comp time and increase overtime in the jail, you're probably talking at least $100,000, maybe more. And then on to
that would be a good bench. I asked Scott that very question at the end of last week, and I think.
And that's just the jail.
But if you put 6 jailers in there, then that's $420,000. Like I said, it can all be fixed with money.
Yeah, the overtime, extra overtime money works great as long as you have people willing to give up their days off to work.
Right.
And I would think that the trend's probably half and half. I've got half that staff over there that, you know, 6 or 8 of them will come every time you call them. They want the money. The time or whatever they get. 6 or 8 says, hey, if you force me, okay, I'll come. And then those other 12 or 15 say, I'm not coming unless you absolutely mandate and direct me to come to work. I want my days off. I get it. I mean, I appreciate that. It's not personal. I'm not mad at them. I understand that's, you have those that do and those that do not want to. So.
I think the problem that comes with the shift work is if it's a consistent thing. Like, they don't ever get their days off, so they're having to come in and fill and work their days off. And for a short period of time, that may be fine for a person, but over a long period of time, your employees get worn out, and they get to a point where they're like, I'm done.
That's part of my interview process.
And I think you're less efficient as an employee with, you know, your job.
When I interview people, that's the question that I ask is, you must be willing, actually my question statement, you must be willing to work overtime when I need to, because everyone's required. You can't opt out. Is that a problem? Yeah.
I think paying the comp time is, I agree with what's been said, but I also agree with you wholeheartedly. I've had a job like that where I work all the time, and it's not going to work.
Yeah.
At some point, somebody's got to stop.
You're right. It works until it don't.
That's right.
And we're very fortunate, too. And I'll tell you, we're pretty much full staff. But it's horror stories on all these other counties that are working with 75% of their workforce in the jail or sick. Polk County has less than 50% workforce left in their jail. They've had to recall all their deputies and their CID to go into the jail to work. And they just can't hire enough. I'm blessed. I know I'm blessed because we are full staff. I have one opening in another week. I'll have one opening. that helps too. We could be having a whole different conversation if we were 75%. So we do have a few things going in our favor. It's not all gloom and doom. But
while I do understand it's cheaper to pay the comp time. I do agree. I would think that to help alleviate some of that problem that he's having, and it's not only to help him, but also to help his employees get some relief. I think some personnel would benefit, would be a great benefit.
I agree. I think one of the things you're seeing, too, law enforcement side, seems like more crime, more violent crime. And it's different than it was even 13 years ago when I got elected. And at some point, unfortunately, we have to pay for that. And
it's just the numbers, Chris.
Yeah.
More population.
Yeah, more population.
Bottom line, we got more people living here. You're going to have more issues. It's just part of it.
And to brag on law enforcement and the courts, very highly respected in the community, because y'all are putting people in jail, y'all are taking them off the streets. We don't have the problems that blue counties or blue states have, and that's very, very commendable. So, but that's very much.
Most of that county court is what Matt said.
Hey, they are afraid to commit crimes. And
I'm totally kidding.
I'm teasing.
Totally
kidding.
I believe some of the department heads, I think if the elected officials and department heads maybe were told what to do, because I know Rebecca had said in the meeting, I go ahead and tell my people to take their time. Well, not all department heads think like that. So a lot of it could be just training or letting those department heads know, not the sheriff's department, but the rest of the departments in the courthouse, hey, you can let them come in 30 minutes late, leave 30 minutes early, an hour, whatever, to offset that time. I think some department heads are busy. They're not thinking like that as far as comp time. We're starting that because I have two officers that they teach classes at night every week. So obviously they come eight to, they're here during the day, but they also teach class, so they are building up some comp time. So we're going to start that, just take off that week or the following week during the pay period, take those hours off and talk in class. Because some department heads need to be told that too.
That's one of the reasons that I have a problem with maybe eliminating comp time completely, because if we have department heads now that are not keeping an eye on the comp time, how much overtime are they going to be letting their employees accumulate? Where will the county be at in a year, because we've had to pay so much out? Because if people aren't being mindful of comp time, are they going to be mindful of overtime?
Well, the people that regulate overtime is sitting right here, and we would make them justify that, or else it ain't going to be there. So,
well, here's what I think on the holiday and the comp time. Let's find out what it would cost to do the holiday proposal that we have, and also to pay the comp time annually and continue to let that accrue and pay it annually, mostly in the sheriff's office. And then we'll come back and have a much shorter discussion with just two options for each. Two options for holiday, either leave it like it is or pay it. And two options for comp time, either eliminate it and pay it out or have caps, but still pay it out annually. Does everybody kind of agree that that's where we're headed?
Yeah.
So comp time at
9:30
was $66,000.
Well, it's about 100 now, because she just sent it to me about 3 or 4 weeks ago, and I think it was 89.
But so that means people have accumulated and taken off throughout the year, so if you pay it out at 9:30, maybe it won't be so high as the 100. I don't know. When you tell people they're going to get paid for it, they're not going to take it.
Are you, we can sit here and discuss this all day on your overtime, and Ellie, is it more in your specialized areas, or is it patrol only?
No, it's patrol. Yeah, I'm doing exactly what Monica's talking about, and Rebecca, and we've been doing that. If you're not on patrol out on the street or in the jail, everybody else, I make them flex that unless they accumulate it within those last day or two before the pay period ends on Saturday night, and I can't give them time off. Yes, we do the same thing. Go home early, come in late. Take an extra hour at lunch, anything to keep from having to bank it or pay it. You bet. We're doing exactly that. And I do it on patrol, too, if on the days that I have a free somebody home early. Hey, you worked over 2 days ago for 3 hours. All 4, 5, 6 of y'all are here tomorrow on patrol, whoever it is. You need to take off 3 hours early or come in 3 hours late so I can get away. And I'm already doing that. So it's just my biggest problem is just those patrol guys, deputies on the street, and just the jailers.
Yeah.
It's not all my specialized units at all. I make them take it off. And clerical, too. We make them take it off.
All right. We will have, again, a shorter discussion next time. We've got comp time and holidays. I think we'll be able to make a decision pretty quick. Does everybody agree with that? Let's talk about the recommended or the discussed and recommended changes for paid time off. I'll just quickly state that we did look at eliminating the personal time, as Commissioner Kirkendall mentioned earlier. However, people won't lose those 2 days. It will be folded into how the HR department had come up with calculating the amount of hours a person would earn each is it pay period. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
So they would still get, you know, as of right now, after a person works here for 12 consecutive months, first of all, during those first 12 months, they get 2 personal days. Those renew after 12 months, plus they get 80 hours of vacation. Now, this is 8-hour employees. That's the easiest way to talk about this starting off. And the way you have this calculated, they would still end up with the same amount of days at the 12-month period, right?
Right, just minus the personal days.
Do you want to kind of discuss that? Has everybody reviewed this and kind of knows where we're at? I think I sent it out about a week or so ago. How exactly would that work?
Basically, what you're looking at now is the personal days are gone. They're not in the personal day bank, and they are in the, we'll call it, the PTO. Everybody is getting the same amount of days, no matter what hours, how many hours you work. They're getting the same amount of days a year, just like they are getting right now. Instead of accruing them once a year, you're accruing them on each pay period. We tried to do monthly. That really didn't work, so it's per pay period. At the end of the day, though, everybody's getting the same thing. The only difference is the sick leave, because initially we started off, let's give everybody 1 day a month. So everybody ends up with 2 more sick days per year than what they get now. But it's still all the same time. Everything is the exact same. It's just calculated in a different way. And that's what all of these charts are. Like I said, it doesn't matter. I did revise it because I had talked to somebody from Road and Bridge, and they said, well, this doesn't calculate right because, you know, our employees work 10 hours a day. So I went through and I recalculated that, and that slide's been added in here.
That's this one.
Oh, there's an error on the number of days there.
Where?
On the regular employees, 10-hour days.
On this slide?
The one after it.
Yes.
That one.
This slide.
Mm-hmm. On the number of days, that column right there, I believe those hours were divided by 8 instead of 10.
Here?
So where it says 12 and a half days,
mm-hmm.
That would actually be 10 days.
Okay.
You're right.
Unless that was an intentional.
Yeah, and it's the same issue on the other page too.
This one?
On some of on the jail and
here.
Yeah, on that one and that one, there's the same issue, just a math issue.
Yeah.
Okay.
Go to the deputy one.
Oh.
Here?
Yeah. So you work, if you're giving him 2 weeks, that should only be 8 days, not 10 days.
Right.
And then 8 days times.
Oh, I'm sorry,
well,
two personal days in there. That's why.
Yeah.
Okay. So you're just gonna give those 2 personal days now as vacation?
Well, if we don't, you're taking something away they already have. That's what we were trying not to do.
They're just going in a different bank. Instead of having a personal day bank, we're getting rid of the personal days and adding those 2 personal days into the vacation. And they're earning those throughout the year like they are their vacation.
And I really appreciate that, because that takes pressure off of them burning their personal days or losing it.
Like I said, overall, everybody is getting the same amount of hours per year. They're just calculated differently and called something different. Basically, it's the same.
So instead of calling it vacation, you're just calling it leave.
PTO.
Yeah, paid time off. Besides the sick leave was left just like like it is, except for they are accumulating two more days a year than what they
bereavement leave, funeral?
Stays like it is.
Stays like it is, so that's totally separate.
Nobody brought that up at all, that was an issue in any department, so we left it like it was.
While we're on that, Melinda, do you have the policy in front of you, the current?
Can you pull it up real quick?
Give
me just a second.
2B8.
You say 2B8? You talking about DPS or something? Or what?
Yeah.
While she's pulling that, let me ask a question back to not the sick time, but the PTO. When does that start? When can they burn that? When, you know, right now we're on a, hey, you got to be here a year to start pulling vacation. You got to be, was it 90 days to use personal leave? Am I right? Y'all help me out there. Okay.
PTO would start accruing the first day they start work.
Okay.
Sick leave would start accruing the first day after they completed their probation. October 1st will be the earliest any of this starts.
So when will they re-up? Is it going to go to a calendar year, or is it still going to be on their anniversary date?
Yep. Or is it going to be October 1?
It's going to be
on one of the other. Or is it going to be October 1?
We talked about October 1st. Some people have said that's a problem for them because all of a sudden you got people rushing in August and September trying to burn their vacation before they lose it. Again, that goes back to a management problem, and Shirley specifically, if you want to talk, or at least let me throw you under the bus here, she starts on the first day. Right now she does it in January. She would probably now go to November if we did it that way and say, hey, everybody needs to put your vacation on the calendar, and that's easy for some departments and not easy for others. So that's why we wanted to kind of have that discussion here today as well.
So if you go to earn it as you go, and let's just say you re-up October 1, everybody understands that you're not going to be able to take a week's vacation off at Christmas or Thanksgiving or anything else because you're only going to have earned 3 days.
Right. You can carry a week over.
You carry one last year's.
Yeah, you can carry 1 week.
Last year's.
But you're only.
But by the time you get to Christmas from October, you've only gained 2 days.
That's correct.
Right? Yeah. Plus you'd have your week from.
You don't have the same policy yet.
And by spring break, you got an employee that wants to take kids on a week. They're off from school for a week. If you start at January 1, they're not going to have a week off.
It's going to take you 5 months for a regular employee. I know it, but it's going to take you about 5 months to accumulate a week's worth of time.
That's the, believe it or not, that's the only pushback out of all this that I'm getting from my staff is earn it as you go. It's caused a storm.
It's not because anybody that is an employee now has all of their time on the books, and we will figure it. Nobody's going to lose any time. So instead of them getting it on their 1 year anniversary and getting it in a lump sum, they'll carry that week over, and then they won't have to wait a whole year to earn, say, their 3 weeks of vacation because they're going to be earning those hours per pay period. So they actually get their time sooner.
When I rolled over in January, I didn't get this year's. I got last year's. I can use all that now. I've worked already for a year till January 12th. I got my vacation. Now I can use that vacation. I earned that last year. So now I start earning every month.
It's what I earned
from last year.
You stay a year behind, sort of how you
So I'm earning as I go.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be.
I can only carry over 1 week. So let's say you did this coming October 1. And I'm going to carry 1 week over. I've got 40 hours. And at the end of October, I've earned 4 point something hours. At the end of November, I get another 4. So by Christmas, I've only earned, forget about my week I carried over. Maybe I was employed, didn't have anything to carry over. I've only earned 3 personal leave days to take.
Unless it's not going to work like that, because like Monica, her anniversary is in January, so I'm going to backdate what she earned from January to October and add that to her balance for October the 1st. So you will actually have time.
Okay, so I understand that if it falls right.
Yeah.
Let's say you get
more hours the longer time you have, too.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I have one employee that his anniversary day is October 2nd. I just know that because I always deal with it every year.
Then they will earn their hours. If they earn 4 hours a month, they will earn those 4 hours for 1 year. So they'll end up having 48 hours in the book.
Already.
Yeah.
October 2nd. They're getting last year's time.
Because nobody's going to lose that on their time.
I know. That is, that's not what earn as you go means.
But it does, because if you're a brand new employee, then you are earning as you go. But the employees that are here already, we have to give them that time that they have already earned. They've already earned that. They're just not getting it in a, on their anniversary date in a lump sum. They're getting it by each month.
That was the other argument that I wasn't getting the emails about. So at the end of this transition year, then from that point going forward, if you go to October 1, you're back to the same issue of, I've only earned 3 days to use. If I chose not to hold a week over, I only have 3 days to use.
That's their decision, because there are people now that will use their 2 weeks of vacation up in the first 3 months that they earn it, and they have no time for the rest of the year, and they have to wait a full year before they get their time. So that is sort of personal management on how they want to do it.
Amen.
Wow.
The one thing that, so okay, the benefit, amen, is going to benefit new hires, because right now you don't have any time. You work a whole year and then you get dumped. You've worked a whole year to get that time.
Right.
So now when you're a new hire, you're going to get a little bit for every time that you've worked. So it's something to look forward to. But people that have been here for a long period of time, it's going to impact. So like me personally, my time rolls in October. Okay, so I'm going to have whatever, if you're prorating the time for the prior year on the old policy, I'm going to have like 120 hours, I'm just saying. Then I'm going to have whatever I have left in my bank that I've rolled over. Then I'm going to have what I'm accruing. So are we going to allow people that are here more time to take that time off? Because they're, for my department, I'm not, that's going to be difficult for me to take that much time in a year.
I think there should be a grace period because of the rollover.
There will have to be, because the first year and maybe the first 18 months are going to be a little bit harder trying to transition everybody into the same plan. So, there has to be more discussion. This is just an overall broad view of how we are looking at accruing time.
And let me say something for everyone's benefit, because Commissioner Young just leaned over and said, why are we even looking at doing this? I hate to.
Well, that was my question.
Very sure, but
no, I was going to say it publicly, but they were having
a discussion. There's two reasons. First of all, a new employee that starts on day one, if they've already got a vacation plan with their family or surgery or lots of other things they might need to be off for, all they're going to get is those two personal days. And I don't know if they get them right away or after 90 days or whatever. Mm-hmm. So there's that. And then the other thing is, the big deal, for at least for me, is we just have so many people that when they get ready to retire, they may be ready to retire at the end of December, but their anniversary date's in April. So they stick around till April so they can get another 2 months of time off, because you end up with all the vacation days and personal days and everything else. And now, either Commissioner's Court has got to fill that, pay extra money to fill that position, because it's a small department. You know, if Debbie had somebody in her office that was to do that, she could not do her job without replacing that person. So we would have to amend the budget to let her get that new person in there sooner, or in the sheriff's case, where he can afford to kind of cover that through comp time or whatever way he's got to do it to cover it, he's got to wait 2 months to replace that position. This is to try to avoid that as well. So this is the reason in looking at that. We did look at, we pulled every county policy from the counties surrounding us, and we didn't find that any of them do what we currently do. And doesn't mean we got to do what they're doing. We're just saying we're looking at this as an option to try to avoid those two circumstances.
On the flip side, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
On the flip side, you have all these employees that will come in and don't make a year. Mm-hmm. When they terminate, we're only paying them whatever holiday comp time. Now they're going to be earning vacation or personal time off as they go.
Right.
That you are going to start paying.
True.
You're going to have to pay this out, you know.
But that was one thing I would like to put in policy, that until they make their 1 year anniversary, we're not paying out their benefits or not paying out their vacation time, because that's what we currently do now. If you don't work here for a year, we don't pay you vacation because you haven't earned it. So So if you don't make, make
now you're flipping to earn as you go.
You're earning as you go, so you're owing
them.
Yes,
you can. It is in several county policies that you do that.
Most often, as you said.
You have to be employed for at least 1 year and you don't get the benefit of the vacation time. Another thing that I would like to add in there, we have employees because we advance everyone 1 week of sick. We are paying out employees 1 week of sick. They're calling in sick and then they're quitting within 3 months or, you know, 6 months. Technically, they should have to give that back to the county. We don't do that. Our policy also states that you don't accrue vacation time if you are not at work. Well, we don't accrue vacation time. It's just given in one big lump sum. So that policy hasn't been followed either. So if you have a new employee, or really any employee that comes in that goes unpaid, and they won't accrue those hours for that pay period because they did not physically work or they did not have time on the books. So in the long run, it really will end up saving the county money. Another thing that I want to point out is we have employees that go off on FMLA, and I'm sure everybody's probably worked with somebody, employees that have been here, you know, just say for 15 years. Something happens, they have to go off on FMLA, they use up all of their time, and they're unpaid for, say, 3 or 4 weeks. That hurts. Whenever they're on FMLA and they're still getting paid, they're accruing time. It may not be a lot, but an employee does not have to wait for a whole year in order to get their time back.
On the sick time accruals, are we going to reward those who have not used it? Like, I've got two or three. I tell my people, you never know if you're going to have a heart attack, someone in your family's going to be hospitalized, save your sick time. So I've got a couple probably with over 400 hours. I wouldn't want to see them penalized with us rolling over because they've been disciplined to be at work and not miss.
We didn't talk about changing the cap. It'll still be 480.
It will still be 480.
Yeah, so they'll keep it.
Okay.
Yeah.
If you took your vacation and you gave them a week of that, for argument's sake, you gave them a week of it on day one when they started here, and you gave them the second week of it when they hit their 1 week anniversary.
1 year.
One year anniversary. That addresses, hey, I'm a new person, but something catastrophic has come up, and I don't have any time off. And I've always said I thought that was unfair for the non-public safety people, because the one luxury that we do have is that deputy or that jailer, he knows I can't take vacation right now, but if I work extra and get comp time, I can turn around the next week. And so all the new ones jump out there and get them 2, 3, 4 days pay of comp time so that they can take it. And I always thought, hey, sure is nice for them. Generally, the 8-to-5 employees don't have that luxury. They come to work here, and they've only been here a month and a half, and something happens that they really need time off for. Could you maybe get to the same end if you just said, hey, we're going to give you a week's vacation, and we're going to give it to you on day one instead of making you wait until, what is it, 6 months or a year?
When it's a year.
Yeah. So instead of getting to a year, if you gave that to them immediately. And
I don't agree with that.
And if they quit inside a year, you got to try to get that money back from them.
But what she's saying is if she's going to make a policy that says they don't get the other when they leave early, do the same thing.
But I'm saying if you advance it, if the policy is you don't get vacation until you're here a year, but we're going to advance you a week first, and then I quit in 6 months, and I've taken that week already, I owe the county back that money that they paid me for that week off that I got advanced. Just like the sick time is.
Yeah.
Although we advance them sick time, lots of people come through here and are off sick for a week and quit in 6 or 8 or 9 months, and we don't make them pay it back. We should, but how are you going to get it back, really, in most cases? You have to end up suing a bunch of them, probably. Yeah. We don't want to get into that.
I mean, if the whole point behind that is to try to give some leave to those people who have been here a short period of time, are there other ways to accomplish that than going through changing everything else about pay as you go, earn as you go?
I love change. It's the way I've always operated.
And then anybody have a recommendation on how to stop the person who's going to retire from staying that extra 4 or 5 months to get that extra 2 months of time? A big lump sum payment at the end when they really was going to retire, you know, in October, November, December, but they stayed until the spring because that's their anniversary day. How do you think of that?
And again, that really affects like the clerk's office, Shirley's office, I would think more.
It affects everybody in some way.
In some way, yeah.
Well, you're still going to have to pay them out. It's just going to be a matter of when you're paying them out because, I mean, like, so for example, take the retiree or someone considering to retire. Right now, it's earn as you go. Well, they can accumulate that time, and you're still going to have to pay whatever they have on the books at that period of time.
But most departments are going to have to wait 2 months to hire somebody to fill that position. Or in the smaller ones, you know, the 2 or 3 person departments, HR, treasurer, and some others, they're going to come to commissioner's court and say, hey, I can't wait that long. I've got to fill it now.
Yeah, they just lost a third of their workforce.
Right.
33%. Right. I mean, they got to have somebody.
We're 50%.
Yeah.
I can try to suck it up a little bit, but they can't. I mean, there's no way. I would say even county attorney, district attorney. I mean, there's just, one person out of 7 or 8 or 9 is, man, that's critical. For me, 1 or 2 out of 70, okay, I can try to absorb that, and I usually do, but I like it when they burn time leading up to leaving, because then I'm not cutting a check, and we're absorbing that leave time, and there is no money out late. But if a guy's just being hard-headed and he knows in his mind, hey, I'm going to leave October 15th is my anniversary date. On October the 16th, I'm going to walk in there and hand you a 2-week, and up until now, you're right, there's nothing we can do about that.
Well, I mean, if you think about it, though, the way our policy is, they've worked all that year, too. They've earned that. So, why? I mean, just a normal person, why would you leave? Why would you leave before you got that time?
I mean, yeah, because we're holding everybody a year behind on their vacation time. This way, we won't. And really, my thought is, and what I've seen a lot in the past, is people will earn or use that time as they earn it a lot of the times, so you end up not having a lot of allowances. Not everybody will do that, but for the most part, whenever you see employees that first year, they always want to take off for something. And so it ends up a lot of that time. Very few people roll 1 week over on, whenever they hit their second year, because they're using their time on the books, and most of the time they're sick leave. The only time you see a lot of high balances are people that have been here for 5+ years.
Mm-hmm. I agree. Can we take a lunch break?
Do we have to change to October, or can we leave after anniversary date?
I'm sorry.
What is the best or easiest change with the earned PTO? To go to the October 1st, we even discussed January 1st, or stick with their anniversary date?
I know we talked about doing one or the other, and if I'm not mistaken, maybe Candace told Melinda it'd either be October 1st or anniversary date, not January 1st for some reason. Is that right?
I didn't want to do that because we have to give the auditor's office, my office has to give the auditor's office balances, and so I didn't want anything overlapping within budget years. So I'm the one that said October the 1st. Okay. I will tell everybody here, Hardin County is probably the only county in the state of Texas that has their employees where they have their own separate anniversary date. And it is very complicated for my office, and especially since we're working in spreadsheets, and there are only 2 of us, but Brittany and I will go with what y'all decide. But I will put that out there. We are behind the times.
I like the anniversary date. It's just my opinion.
Does everybody want to leave it anniversary date? I mean, what's best for everybody?
It's just a calculation.
It's the same amount of time.
Yeah, it's the same time, but it is a calculation. It makes
all
it more difficult.
Now is if we go to the PTO, it's just the date that you have to use it or lose it. That would be your date. So leave it anniversary date.
I like that.
Okay.
I think most employees are more comfortable, especially those that have been here a long time. Well, that's my anniversary date.
I mean, there is a downside to making everyone the same, because then you have all your employees trying to take off at the same time, but I mean, you have that in other places of employment as well. Another thing too is that the the calculation, if we do it by pay period, how are the hours going to be trued up? Because if you take a figure like that, it's not going to equal out the total number of hours for the year. Or is there going to be a true, some are more, some are less, based on rounding?
Let's decide, are we looking favorably towards the PTO or leaving it like it is, and then we'll figure out the calculations before it's a done deal, if it, you know, if it goes that direction. Anyone? Nubbin's hungry, he says he ain't talking no more to you.
What was the consensus of the committee?
The PTO, I believe, is that right?
Mark, you got the biggest department. You said you've heard negative on this from your employees.
Yeah, and obviously it may be maybe an understanding issue.
Matt's on the committee, and he says his employees don't like it either.
I want to take an opportunity to sit down and let her go through and walk me through and maybe educate me, because I'm still not making this make sense.
Yeah, it sounds very complicated.
For the sake of what? Well, what are we trying to accomplish? All of this got started over what?
I can get the whenever an employee wants to leave and they have time on the books that they have to spend. I was in a two-person office also. I had to work by myself for 6 weeks. It was rough, but I did it. And I can see where some offices would not be able to do that. I want my paycheck. I know everybody else wants their paycheck. That would not work for you. It sounds really complicated. I think it would take a lot of education for me and everybody else.
Give me your take. What is the benefit of doing that to the county? And we're managers. We're executives talking about saving taxpayer money and saving the county money. What is the benefit of doing that? And I'm saying there's not. But educate. Well, what is the benefit of doing that?
The number one benefit in the long run is that whenever you go to this system, 9 times out of 10, people use their time as they accrue it. And especially when you have new employees come in. So therefore, if an employee quits, you're not looking at paying out 3 weeks worth of vacation, because most of the time they will have already used it up. And it's hard to see that now because of the way that things are. But if you really go through and you kind of study it and you see, it will end up, it's not something that's going to happen overnight. But in the long run, it will save the county money. Because like I said, most people are going to use it. And as the younger ones come in, everybody has kids. They've always got to be off for something with their kids. They're sick, or if anybody gets sick, things like that. And they'll end up using that time almost as soon as they earn it. And it ends up being a big financial savings for the county. And also another thing is, we're not paying employees out that only decide to work here for 3 months and use up that week of sick leave.
But those are not hurting us right now anyway. That's not your focus. Those are not the people that you're cutting a big 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 week comp time check to. So those shouldn't even be in the discussion. Because if you're talking about saving money, those people don't have anything to do with that. It's the long-term employee who's leaving here. The auditor's over here shaking her head, yes, sir. It's the long-term employee who leaves that we're trying to address now. So if we want to do that, that's great. Let's be honest and throw it out here and tell the county employee, we don't want to spend these big checks. We're trying to come up with a way to soften the blow when you leave. And I'm okay with that. But why do we have to change everything to address it that way? If that's the only benefit that pay as you go or earn as you go.
Well, it's not only that, it's also for the employees, because like I mentioned, somebody that goes out on FMLA and they come back and they have to wait 6 months before they get time and they still need to have things like therapy or follow-up appointments, they're not having to go unpaid whenever they may have already had to go unpaid for 3 weeks. You know, it's so there's a benefit to both sides.
So do we know about how many we've had like that in a year? How many people fall into that category?
I was going to say, right off the top of my head, I can probably think about 5 employees. And that's just off the top of my head. I have an FMLA folder in my office about that big. So So it's not just a benefit to the county, it's a benefit to the employee.
That fits in that category for the last 6.5 years.
I had one this past fiscal year.
I think the other benefit, I guess, if you're...
But he was paying.
I had the same issue Mark had. When I first came here, I had the same issue. It made no sense to me. I don't know why we were changing it. But the other benefit, I guess, would be, let's say you have a scenario where you have an employee who has a big vacation planned in a year, and they use it. Well, then they have to wait an entire year before they get their vacation back. Whereas under this system, I guess you would be gaining it to where you could take a day or two here during the course of that year. So I guess that'd be the other benefit to your employees would be that. But yes, my office hates it. My entire office, except for Kalea, who's brand new, she likes it because she would be able to take vacation, you know, starting immediately. But everybody else says, why change it? It makes no sense to change it. We like it the way it is. We like getting all of our hours at one time. And we plan our years. And I'm similar to, and I can't remember who it was. It was Shirley, I think. Shirley and I talked about it. I'm similar to her. We have a calendar that we all are on it together. And we put on our vacations every year. It's all on the calendar at all times. So we know. And they, my employees, know in advance. I'm getting my 80 on January 2nd. And I'm going to put my calendar on this. And they prefer doing that as opposed to having to accrue it every pay period.
That's how we do it, too.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be a very difficult transition, because also the issue you're going to be transitioning is what Eric was talking about. You're going to have people having a lot of vacation on the first year you transition this, and it's going to be a lot of people taking off a lot more time in their first year.
I just cannot understand how it would save the county much money. Maybe in the long run with a long-term employee, but if currently we have a new employee that doesn't have any time and they take off, we're not paying them.
Right.
So it wouldn't save us any money. We're not spending any money.
That's true.
I did like this program when I was in Liberty. I will say, in Liberty, this is the program we had. I think your problem is a transition program.
Yeah,
exactly. Because at the onset, this is a very good program because I'm gaining hours. If I need to take a Friday off, it was very easy for me to be like, okay, in 2 weeks, I'm going to have 8 hours.
Yeah.
But now, with the program you have now, it's going to be very difficult to make that transition where you're not going to have a complicated problem.
Could we grandfather, and then all new hires after October 1st go to the new system?
That's something we should look into.
And then... the other thing, too, is...
Did nobody hear me say we're still working in spreadsheets?
So that's the major problem, is that right now we're having issues maintaining what we have, and everybody's on a different anniversary date and getting a lump sum. Now you're talking about touching every person, 26 pay periods, manually.
And so then the other question is, if we do decide to stay with what we got, can we still do away with the personal time and put it in PTO? And just change it from vacation to PTO, give it a different language, and get rid of the use it or lose it, 2 days, if we decide to do the same.
So just give 2 extra vacation days versus giving personal days.
So they can take them whenever they want to throughout the year and without a use it or lose it, because they could potentially roll those 2 days over because they're now PTO.
Well, I don't think so, because you can only roll over 40 hours of vacation. So you would have to change that to, well, in offices or your department, it would be 60 hours because they have 10-hour days for their personal days.
So.
And if you roll up to a vacation, do they lose the ability to use it?
Within 90.
Right.
So you got to be here 90 to use it.
Just tell them to use 2 days of PTO. If we change the language, use 2 days of PTO after 90 days, and then you got the other, you know what I mean?
You're
you got
really
2 days,
I mean,
and just change it to PTO instead of vacation and personal days, because I find personal days very tormenting.
But you would still have to use them before your 1 year anniversary.
I'm sure they would, but because they can only roll that over. But
yeah, because they could only roll over 40 hours.
But I would also vote to do away with personal days.
Let's take all this under advisement, and the committee will revisit all of this, and I'll be glad to work with y'all on that. Any input that anybody wants to give to the court or the committee, we all remain open, as always. Let's take a 15-minute recess, and we'll come back and start on the ARPA discussion.
What does the funeral policy say?